at Temple this morning over at Adamsville. Those who don't know, we're going this morning. We don't have a baptismal pool. Hallelujah. So we're going to go and fellowship with them. We're going to baptize some people today. All right? Hallelujah. Thank you for the ones who going to say, take me to the water. Amen. Hallelujah. Take me to the water so I can be baptized. Is that right? Preston? Yeah. You going to sing it for us? That's what the song said. It's going to give you the mic this evening, but you can lead us in that song. Hey. That's going to be all right? All right. You can't be singing another thing now.
I was just singing myself.
Amen. We're gonna sing with you. How about it? We're gonna sing with everybody. Gonna sing with it.
Yeah.
All right. We're gonna sing with it. Take me to the water. None but the righteous. Amen. Turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 28, verse 19. We're gonna take a little bit, somewhat of a detour. We're not taking a detour. Just gonna drill down a little bit. We've been on a journey. We're still on that journey. Seeing Christ on his way to Calvary, starting in the book of Genesis. So this morning we're going to continue our journey of Christ going to Calvary. But we're going to take the time this morning to drill down into some pieces that Christ made obvious for us about baptism. Is that all right? Make sure everybody understands what the Lord is saying. Clearly see, right, what the Lord is saying. Hallelujah. All right. Matthew 28, starting verse 19. We understand that Jesus came to the earth for a purpose. Hallelujah. Amen. He came to the earth for a purpose. And that purpose, he said, was to destroy the works of the wicked one. Amen. He also said he came to seek and to save, right, those who were lost. Amen. He said he did not come to the world to condemn the world, but that them who believe on him would be what? Saved. So we know already that if you have not received the finished work of Jesus Christ, you're already condemned. That's the thing he was trying to make clear. That we already have condemnation. Excuse me just a second.
Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. All right. All right. We already have condemnation that is looming overhead, but he came that we might be saved. Now, at the end of his journey, Jesus made a command to his disciples. And because we are here studying to be disciples of Jesus Christ, it's important that we understand the command that he makes, starting with verse 18. Call this the Great Commission. Matthew 28, start with verse 18. And it says, and Jesus came up and spoke to them, who is them? His disciples, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. So first thing he wanted us to understand is he has been given all authority. So Jesus, at this point, we have skipped ahead in our journey with Christ to the end. And he said, says all authority. Something you need to understand about authority is this, is that authority is always something that is given. Authority is a type of power. Everybody say power.
Power.
Authority is a type of power. But the thing about that makes authority different is authority is something that is always given. Authority is delegated. It's something that is given. Amen?
Amen.
You can try to take authority, but that's a dictatorship. And that authority is not genuine. If you try to take authority over people, over a thing. Authority has to be given or delegated. So any authority I have in this church has been what? Given to me. All right? So that means that the actual authority belongs to what? Someone else. So the authority I have to be the pastor and leader of this church is not really my power at all. It's me operating whose power?
God's power.
God's power. And anyone that I give authority to in this church, they're not really walking in their power. They're walking in power that I gave them that belong really to
God.
Him. All right, let's just talk about authority for just a second. So we need to understand that when the Bible says, that Jesus says, all authority has been given unto me in heaven and in earth, then he's saying that the Father, after I've completed my work, now this that he's speaking is after the cross, okay? For those of you who may not know this particular passage, this is after Jesus has gone to the cross, after he has presented his blood to the Father as payment for our sin, after he has finished his work on earth. He didn't say this until he had finished his work. So there was something that he had to do in order to receive this gift. So he did his work, and then he says unto his disciples, all authority now has been given to me on heaven and between heaven and earth. Now watch this. This is very important. Who was given the authority of heaven and earth first? Who was given the authority of heaven? I mean, excuse me, the authority of earth. But heaven in this particular thing, he's got two authorities that he's talking about. But first, who was given authority on earth?
Adam and Eve.
So he now has taken back the authority of the earth. Also, the Father has also given him with it the authority of heaven. So he's making a statement that has some connotations. He's saying to us that now the powers that be, it's just like boxing. Somebody mentioned boxing earlier. They were talking about Deontay Wilder. He's a champ. I said, yeah, he's a heavyweight champ, but he don't have all the belts, I don't think. He don't have all the belts, but he got one or two of them. You know, back in the day when we had Muhammad Ali and we had Mike Tyson and all that, those were the days of having the united one champion had all the belts. You understand what I'm saying? So you could at one point in time, you can have two or three heavyweight champions, the IBA, the IBO, the all them different, you know, federations that declare somebody a champion. So I know Muhammad Ali had all the belts. Mike Tyson had all the belts. But most of the time, you don't have heavyweight champions that have all the belts. Well, Jesus is saying, I got all the belts. Ain't no other champions but me. Are you with me now?
Okay.
He says, now all authority in heaven and in earth are given to me. And so he's saying there is no higher authority than me. Are you with me? Y'all act like that's exciting, y'all. See, I work for the ultimate authority in earth and heaven. Amen?
Amen.
See, we don't read the way we should. If we read the way we should, then we would understand that when you say you surrender it all to him,
for all that he has, guess what? We're talking about the person that has all power in heaven and in earth. Even the Father has delegated to him to have the final say-so on whatever you want to do here. Are you with me? So when Jesus speaks, the Father says, okay. And so when we give Jesus our lives, we're actually giving him access to give us that same authority. The authority doesn't lose power. So the actual authority by which I pastor this church is the same authority that Jesus walks in. That's hard to receive, man. It don't lose power. He didn't give me a B grade of it. He didn't give me a watered down version of his authority. He gave me his authority to walk in here. I'm going to show you in a minute. But watch this. If I understand, though, that it is given delegated authority, then that means I am always under subjection to his rule and his reign. Part of the reason why we don't walk in the fullness of what God wants is because we don't want to be put in subjection to his authority. When the president chooses people to work with him in the government, he is delegating to them his authority. When you have foreign ambassadors, when you have an attorney general, when you have all these people, they actually operate in the authority of the president, which is the authority of the United States. So it's very important that you choose people who have the country's best interests in heart, right? Jesus is about to delegate authority to his disciples. And he's about to go. He says, greater works shall you do because I go to the Father. He is about to go because it's better for him to go and sit on the right hand of the Father than it is for him to stay and to walk the earth as one man to try to govern this earth. He'll govern it better from here as he governs it through us. Are you with me? When he is requesting that we surrender all, when he says, if any man shall come unto me, let him deny himself, you have to understand that it's important that you are willing to deny yourself, because he's about to surrender authority to you that disrupts the powers that be. He's surrendering authority to you so that you can properly assist him in the redemption of lost people. People's lives are at stake. And here we are concerned about petty things. But he says, if any man shall come unto me, let him what? Deny himself. Because what's at stake here is me surrendering to you my authority in the earth. So when you see the word authority, it is the same thing that happens when you leave your oldest child in charge of the house. You leave them with full authority. Y'all do what he said, right? Y'all do what she said. When you come back and they don't do what he or she said, then the full wrath of the powers that be is coming down, right? Am I right? Because if you don't back up that authority, guess what? Then it won't ever work, right?
So next time you leave, they're gonna tear it up. Word, they're gonna really tear it up this time because you ain't back up the authority. Are you with me? So God is obligating himself to back you up when you walk in his authority. And so it's important to him to know that you are not going to waste his authority trying to please yourself. Hmm? So there has to be a death to self so that he can live through you. Talk about being baptized. If we don't understand the necessity, then what will happen is, how many times have we had to get little bro, big bro, little bro? Come on now. How many times have we had to tell big bro, come on now, let on. No, now he little now. Let him. Don't do that. The little bro swinging on him. You want to swing back. See, but when big bro swing, he'll knock little bro out. Little bro swinging, he ain't hurting big bro. But when big bro swing, come on now, and knock him out. Come on now, that's right, big bro. But the thing is, when you release your authority and you leave the house and big bro in charge, you need to know that big bro ain't going to get in his cell. You gotta know that big bro gonna do what daddy would do, which is use some discretion, use some grace and some peace. Because at the end of the day, everybody gotta win here. See, but when we get into ourselves, we'll make it so only we win. And we'll be all right, we'll be somewhere smiling. Knock him out. Mama, I don't know what's wrong with him. I knocked him out an hour ago, he ain't moved since. He started it, though. I'm telling you now, he started it. Do you care who started it? The boy Jaw broke. Care about who started it? Because at the end of the day, God is knowing that we are not capable. We're not capable of doing this alone.
Amen.
In our flesh. Our flesh is the reason why we're not already walking with God the way we're supposed to. The flesh is the reason why we had to get kicked out of the garden so that we wouldn't immortalize our flesh. Are we?
Amen.
Amen.
So he says, all authority has been given unto me in heaven and on earth. Go ye therefore and make disciples of all nations. Don't we got some beautiful banners? Y'all see that banner? Ain't that beautiful? Ain't that beautiful? I can't hear y'all. All right. I'm gonna nod ahead. I wanna hear something. Got some beautiful ones all around. They remind us of things that God has said that keep us in check with our identity. Amen? Amen. I especially love this one. She knew that too. Sister Wilma, thank you. This banner all around the world. You know that? This banner all around the world. Mm-hmm. Amen. So that's why you have to go and do what God say do. Amen? Well, she made this banner. She didn't know it was going to go behind some folks that's from international all over the place. And the banner now all over the world. We got over 1,200, I think, 1,500 Facebook friends. And all of them see that banner standing behind them on the video. Amen? So you have to go and do what God tells you to do when he tells you to do it. Is that all right? That was a commercial. All right. But he said, go ye therefore into all the world and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I command you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Now, it is interesting, very, very interesting to me that he would say this. He's got an elevator speech, right? Got a few moments that he spends to say something. So when you got elevator speech, remember I always tell you, we do our 5-minute exhortation to get us used to being able to say something impactful in a few words, right? So if he only had a few words, why did he include being baptized when it's something that we don't really even take serious? Huh? This man start this whole conversation out by saying all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Huh? I am the macho muchacho. Huh? I am it. There is none above me. And so I got to give you some instruction. It's only going to be a couple of sentences. And in those couple of sentences, he says, go ye into all the world, baptize. Huh? Isn't that interesting? With all that he said in all of the Bible, in this little bit that he got left to say something to them before he goes, he said, go ye into all of the world and baptize. Huh? So there must be something, right, to this baptism. Hmm? Come on, we're going to walk it out. There's got to be something. Go ahead and turn to, I ain't got the two scriptures. Romans 6. I got a bunch of scriptures, actually, but I don't know if we'll get to them. But these two, I said, if I don't get to the rest of them, we got to get to these two. Matthew 28 and Romans 6, starting with verse 1. But he says, go ye into all the world and baptize in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, for the conservation of time, I normally would, if we didn't have somewhere to go today, I would take some time to explain what this is saying myself. But I'm going to let Romans 6 explain it. And then if we have time, we'll go to about 20 other scriptures that further explain it. Say, man, you didn't know that many scriptures about baptism in the Bible, did you? Yeah, that's quite a bit said about baptism. Romans 6. Hallelujah. And it reads, starting verse 1. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Mm. He said, now I'm talking to church folk. And he said, in Romans chapter 5, we were talking about sin. In Romans chapter 6, he goes on to expound upon it a little further. He says, shall we then go on sinning longer? Should we continue to just keep on sinning? We have all sinned, the Bible said, in a shape, in iniquity. The wages of sin are what? Death. The gift of God is what? Eternal life. So we know a little bit about sin. And he's asking the question, will we continue to live in sin? He said, of course not. We are those who have died to sin. Or did you not know that when you were baptized into his what? Death. And the issue is that we don't really know that we were baptized into his death. We didn't really know that his death was a part of what we received, of what we entered into. We didn't really know that. We were just told Jesus loved you. You receive that and believe that you are saved. Huh? Ain't what we were told?
Right.
You believe Jesus loved you?
Yes.
You believe he died on the cross for your sins?
Yes.
You saved. I didn't know I was baptized into his what?
Death.
Huh? So I read Brother Belay's book, huh? And the first thing he writes in the book is, you are dead. And that he didn't know he was dead. Amen? The greatest discovery that you'll find is that you are dead. But There's more. Somebody said there's more.
There's more.
Ain't that a good thing? Amen. If it was just that I was dead, then I'd be what it be. It would be hard for me to just sit here. I'd be like, I'm gonna go eat some chicken. But I need to know if I'm dead, then now what do I have? Because Jesus said all authority in heaven and earth has been given unto him. He said that he had given authority unto me, that greater works I would do. But I'm dead. So they didn't understand that Jesus came to die so that he might what? Rise again. Amen. Because there's a necessity for the old man to die so that new life might come forth. There's necessity for a grain of corn to go on the ground and die so that more corn might come forth. Amen?
Amen.
We did that in school. Remember we had that corn and we put it in some water. Huh? That corn was looking nice, just called like a piece of popcorn, right? You might want to pop it. One kernel of popcorn would have been frustrating. Am I right about it? What would have been the good to pop one kernel of corn? Huh? Would have been just make you frustrated. Am I right about it? So it was no good alone, huh? Boil it. How about we boil that one kernel? No good, right? But if that kernel dies, everybody say die.
Yes.
When we put it in that water, that kernel died from what it was, the husk of it, and everything began to disintegrate. And all of a sudden we saw what? Little sprouts come out of it, right? New life came when it what?
Died.
Come on now, y'all better stay with me. So the thing must first die. Unless a kernel of corn goes in the ground and dies, it abides alone. But if it dies, then it becomes the firstborn of many brethren. Amen? So Jesus understood this principle, so he came here to die. So that we might live. And so that he might live, so that he might be the life that comes forth from your death. Can you see that? Good vision, right? You see that? You can see that little corn. See, I thank God for the elementary school teachers that made us put that corn in that water, sit it out there put in the glass, sit in the one, and the thing just started sprouting. Bean or whatever you did. Some of you used beans, some of you used corn, whatever it was you put in there, it sprouted. See, when you can see that visual, then you can understand that there's a light inside of you, but it will not come forth until you what? So we're not talking about being dead, done, put you in the ground, and then bury you and don't nothing happen. We're talking about being dead so that you might live. So that the true you might come forth. I may need to just pause for a minute and remind you of who you are. You are a triune being. That means you are a body, a soul, and a spirit. You comprise all of these. It's probably more like this. So here's your body. Here's your soul. And here's your spirit. Okay? Deep inside of you, there's a spirit waiting to come forth. Amen?
Amen.
But we only know life in the body. And so our body comes in contact with the world. Our body knows what? Everything. And our body knows everybody. Huh? And because our body is just a thing, it needs a place to deposit its information. And it does that in your soul. Your soul is like the black box. It's like internal storage. Huh? And so the soul collects information as the body reacts with the world. Are you with me? So here you are living life, and your body is touching things and feeling things and know what's hot and what's cold and how something feels and all this good stuff. And your body is getting all these good feelings and all that. And so your body seems to be alive. But your body is only as alive as the spirit that gives it life. Amen?
Amen.
So you only have a certain degree of life really going on, just a residual thing. You have a residual life that's going on inside of you. Because your spirit gained its strength from his spirit. Amen?
Amen.
But he made you with some cellular energy inside of you that allows the body, like a battery, to have life from this internal battery. But if it is never charged, it will die one day. Amen?
Amen.
So you come into this world with a battery charged to go about 100 years. Huh? Used to be the batteries held a lot longer. They used to go 900 years. Come on now. Back in the days of Methuselah and all them. But see, now you got a battery that's different, and it only go about 100 years. Some longer than others. And so you come into the world with an opportunity to experience things in the body, recorded in your soul. But if you never bring your spirit online, if you never find a charger, I saw you back there, you will never get life. Amen? So you got to understand that God wants to recharge and bring forth something that you ain't never experienced. You didn't know what all the thing can do. It can only do certain things with that battery, huh?
Amen.
But if you plug it up to the computer, amen? If you plug it up to the power source, now the screen stays on. Now you can go online. Now you can do all this other stuff. But with the battery, you can only do what? Certain things, amen?
Amen.
So here is your life. But we think that our life is the express time that we spend in the body. We think that this is life. Just this external touches and feelings that we get. And so we get caught up in it. In drugs and sex and all kind of things that you say, what's wrong with it? The problem is, it has got you captivated and captured, and you'll never get down to the spirit of man. I mean, spirit that God put in man. Because you will never get past your affection to the things of the flesh.
Amen.
The problem with the flesh, God made it. So you say, well, why can it be wrong? When loving you is wrong, I don't want to be right. And all that kind of stuff. Huh? If it feel good, do it. Mm-hmm. Amen. We all that, I understand why you say that. But what you got to really understand is this. Is that if you get caught, captured in it, you will never break free on your own to the life that God wants for you. It's the problem with the flesh is that you're captured in a place that's going to mean your destruction because your battery is running down.
Yes.
Because of the sun and the moon, the way God set it up and oxygen and all of that, that battery, it keeps moving, it keeps working. One day he's going to take the sun and the moon away. And then the battery's all going to stop. Everything that ain't in Christ Jesus, everything that hadn't changed your new operating system going to die. Huh? I'm inviting you to upgrade. Somebody say upgrade.
Upgrade.
To a new operating system. Because if you don't upgrade to a new operating system, this is going to run out. But see, now some people, they don't believe it. Huh? I love one to sell. Amen. My wife was talking about she had a fit yesterday trying to do something on the computer that said you can't you with yourself with it. She tried to make it do it, but it wouldn't do it with it. You got to upgrade, huh? If we don't understand, then we will find ourselves obsolete. Is that all right?
Amen.
All right, that was commercial. All right, so once you understand this, let's get back to what he's saying here about body, soul, about being baptized, right? All right, we're in Romans chapter 6. All right, he says, or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. Ain't that what I just said? He wants you to live a new life. So even though the baptism may seem a little bit scary, without it, you can't upgrade. unless you are willing to lay your old life down so that new life can rise up. You can't upgrade. You can't keep both. No dual operating system. You're operating on one or the other. Now, just because you upgrade to Windows 10 don't mean you know how to use it, huh? And Windows 8 was impossible to figure out.
Right.
I hate Windows 8. With a passion. That's why they made Windows 10 and gave it away, because they knew it was garbage. I could not get Windows 8 to do nothing. I couldn't get off one screen to another. It just stopped everything I knew about computers, and just, it was crazy to me. Now, some people who very tech savvy, of course, they easily moved into it. But in the process, we got to understand that you, just because you upgrade, don't mean you know how to use the new system. Just because you decide, and some of y'all have been asking questions about what happens after I'm baptized. I baptized one time, and it seemed like it didn't take, huh? Mm-hmm. Like the S-curve. My mama tried to give my neighbor. He tried to get that boy S-curve for 3 days. That S-curve still ain't took. I said, mama, his hair gonna fall out. There you go. Some of y'all feel like the baptism didn't take, you understand? The first time. And so I understand the frustration with it. Especially if it was done without anybody there to help you to walk through the upgrade. Amen? But now you have someone to help you walk through the upgrade. Amen? So I want you to understand that at first when you upgrade, you still ain't going to know how to, you still are not, for the teachers, going to know how to use this new system. Amen. It's going to be a period of relearning, but that's okay. There's going to be a period where you're going to want to try to do things the way you used to do them. You're going to jump on and try to, and you're going to see it's not going to work. Now watch this. That's to be expected. Okay? Look at your neighbor and say, that's to be expected.
That's to be expected.
So you need to understand that there's going to be a learning curve. There's going to be some time that you're going to have to spend getting used to it. Now, but God gives you a manual. If you don't have one, we'll give you one. Huh? He got manuals. It's called the Word. Amen. You are now living your life according to the Word. I was telling this to the Discovery Hour class this morning. Josh did a good job of teaching us on the book of John. Boy, I know some words on it. But I made this one comment. I was telling them that on yesterday, I felt like a fish out of water. I've been walking in the spirit so that I haven't been really making a big deal out of it. It's just been a period where I just feel like I've just been walking in the spirit. And so God been just kind of dictating me what to do every day. I get up, he kind of give me instructions, I go. Well, yesterday, I felt like I was off beat. I just didn't know what it was. I'm like, I got up, I had to come over to church before we unload the bread. But right after that, I just felt like, okay, you're not doing what you need to be doing. So I just kind of peeled and I started slowing down, because I said, what I've learned is that I don't want to walk outside of the spirit. I used to just get up and go. I should get up and go according to my feelings. Huh? According to the things that happen in my soul. You know, in my soul I have records of situations and feelings and they attach to one another. I have feelings that's attached to different situations. So when I get in certain situations, I have records of how I overcame at other times. So I get in that mode. Huh? I get in certain modes. One of the reasons why my wife and I had trouble communicating at one point in our marriage is because she would be talking to me, but whatever key word strike she made, I would begin to think I knew where she was going. Huh? I wasn't listening to hear listening to see what she was saying. I was just hearing what she was saying. And when I heard what she said, in my soul, there were certain records that it attached to. She starts saying things like, you know, well, you know, the tuition bill is coming around. You know, if we don't get it soon, we'll be 2 months behind. And, you know, the car, it needs to be really been taken care of. And, you know, the grass, you know, and this. And all of that to me said, money. All of that to me said, it's a money issue. So really, the rest of what she was saying was like this, wah, 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 wah. So I didn't hear nothing that she said. I'm thinking, you know, I started thinking in my mind, well, my boy did want me to come up there and cut the tree down. Or I could take that little side job or whatever, off me over. So I'm already moved on, right? But we had the same conversation again in another week. And I done brought money. I need the tree job. And I brought the money, but we still had the same conversation. Now I'm mad. Woman, I did what you asked me to do, but did she ever ask me for money? See, what we don't understand is we have a black box. We have a soul. Our soul is a recorder. It just records. It does not have the Spirit of God. When the Spirit of God is not attached to your soul just does what a computer would do. It'll give you just like when you're typing in your phone and you're trying to type in one thing and then type in something else. Mm-hmm. And then if you don't look at that text, you're going to send a text saying the wrong thing. Come on now. See, that thing don't really have a brain for real. It's a smartphone, but it's only as smart as you make it. Huh? And see, if the Holy Spirit is not connected with my soul will make a fool of me. Yeah. Because it has the records to show that this is how this goes. Or if you see this, it mean that. Mm-hmm. Huh? If he said that, girl, that's what it mean. I'm telling you, girl. Don't you believe it. If he said that, I can tell you right now, it mean he did this. Because your soul, everybody say my soul.
My soul.
See, your soul is not necessarily spiritual. It is what God gave you to be able to retain who you are. Your soul is your identity. It is who you are. See, spiritually, we're all the same. We made out of the same spiritual matter.
Amen.
We're all made out of from the same spirit. But my soul makes me different from you or him or whatever. My son looked like me, but he's different. His soul is different because his things he's been through is different. Huh? Mm-hmm. The recordings in his soul are different. I made sure some of them were different. And then sometimes I wonder, was I right in not allowing him to go through some of the stuff I went through? Because then I see things sometimes like it's missing. Mm-hmm. But we're talking about the soul. Are you with me?
Amen.
So if you understand these things that I'm telling you, then you understand that without you being connected to the Spirit, you can be out here doing good stuff. That's why we just, in the discipleship class, the teacher was saying, in the book was saying, your flesh cannot please God. Because your flesh is going to try to please God without consulting with God. Huh? Your flesh thinks it knows because of its experiences. And you can't argue with a person's experiences. Huh? If every time a man said, I love you to a woman, he ended up doing something to hurt her, you can't tell her that love is wrong. It's not wrong. You can't tell her that. She's going to tell you, honey, if he start telling you love, you run. Turn the other way. I don't want no man to tell me love me. I done met him. That's the worst thing you can do, tell her that you love her. Last 10 guys told me they love me, left me, stole my car, ran on my, you know, stole my money at my bank, huh? Left me standing at the altar, huh? You don't know what folk done been through, but it's in the soul. Somebody said the soul.
So
in your soul, there's all of this stuff, and it's real, and it's for real. But at the end of the day, unless it connects with the Spirit, it's not accurate. Or as my wife likes to play around with, accurate. It ain't accurate. And you gotta make sure that what you're doing is accurate, and the only way you can do that is by walking in the Spirit. Are you with me?
Amen.
The only way you can walk in the Spirit, you first must what? Die. So the understanding that we have then is through baptism, we die in the flesh so that we might live in the spirit. Are you with me?
A little bit more.
For if we have been united with him in death like he is, verse 5, in Romans 6, verse 5, for if we have been united with him in a death like he is, we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like he is. For we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. So that your body, he says, has been done away with. In other words, your body is no longer in the driver's seat. Your body now is along for the ride. You gotta hear me. See, where your body used to drive and take you where it wanted to go, now your body is along for the ride. You gotta discipline your body. Huh? I have to tell my body, no, that's why we fast every year. Beginning of the year, we fast. So that you can know throughout this year, you got to be able to tell your flesh what? No. I don't care what you tell it no to the first time. Tell it no to sodas. Tell it no to pork. Tell it no to meat. Tell it no to whatever, sweets. But whatever you do, you got to learn how to tell your flesh no, because your flesh will jump in the driver's seat and you be talking about, I can't help it. Can't stop it. The last thing you want to hear from somebody who's bringing destruction in your life is that they can't help you. Huh? Do you want to hear that? Is that acceptable? But if they never told their flesh no, then guess what? They in their mind, they're telling you the truth. Can't help you. Can't stop it. Because anyone, verse 7, who has died has been set free from sin. Now, if we die with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has majesty over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Is that plain? Amen. So when he died to sin, but not so that he can just say, I'm free from sin. Now I can do what I want to do. Because that would be starting all over again the same process. Because who's going to be in charge once he go back? Once sin have been eradicated in the flesh, who's going to be in charge on the next go round? Huh? Self coming right back. Huh? He gonna resurrect. He coming right back. See, so what you have to do is once you die to sin, become what? Alive to God. Now God has access. So now you understand what I meant when I said yesterday I felt like a fish out of water, because I was going and God wasn't with me. I knew he wasn't. He was somewhere else working. I'm on the wrong job site. I'm like, where I'm at? And nobody tell me we've changed jobs. I felt like that for most of the day. I came home, my wife said, you all right? I said, not really. I said, but I'm just walking slow. I just had to walk slow. Eventually, God got me where he wanted me. And when he did, stuff that I had been trying to do for a solid month, I promise you, got done in a few minutes. Just a minute with him. Mm-hmm. See, but you gotta determine in your heart that you're not gonna go on without him. Mm-hmm. What is the point of going on without him? Making messes that you're gonna want him to clean up. Huh? Mm-hmm. We've made so many messes with our life, so many decisions that now we don't know how to get him straightened out. He comes in, he begins to straighten it out. Then we say, oh, I'm good now. And we go right back to making the same kind of messes. If you are dead to the flesh, become alive, who? To God.
Finish this. Maybe if I don't preach, I just read it. He's preaching his own message today. Verse 8. Verse 11, in the same way, count yourself dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its evil desires. He's doing a good job. Preaching. Therefore, he says, do not let sin have authority in your mortal body so that you obey its evil desires. Do not offer any part of yourself to sin as an instrument to wickedness, but rather offer yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and offer every part of yourself to him as an instrument for righteousness.
Now, I got to make a decision whether I really want to be clean, because I like some of my dirt. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
Like some of our dirt. So the question now becomes, do I really want to be clean? Remember the message that I preached several months ago when I said, find your pleasure. What?
In the Lord.
It was for this purpose that I preached those messages. Because when you came to the realization that it's important for me to die, it's important for me to live unto God, the problem that you're going to run into is, where will I find my pleasure? Huh? Because you're going to want to have pleasure. Amen? But I want you to understand that you can find pleasure in the Lord. Huh? Amen. That's why he told Adam it wasn't good for him to be alone. Huh? Because if he found pleasure alone, it wasn't going to be pretty slight. So he said it ain't good for Adam to be alone. So he made Adam a woman. Huh? So they could find that pleasure together. He gave them the whole earth to ride and romp and ride zebras and do all kinds of stuff and get on waterfall and swim down to the bottom and build a boat and ride and canoe it and all that. They was in the tropics. Come on now. They had plenty to do. The only pleasure they weren't supposed to have was the one he told them to stay away from. Remember right about it. But they had to choose to have their pleasure outside of the Lord. And so now here we are. Messed up. Huh? And we say if we could go back, we'd tell them don't do it, right? So now you can't go back and tell them not to do it, but you can tell yourself not to do it. Huh? Find your pleasure in the Lord. It's going to take some work. Huh? It's going to take some work for you. I was talking to somebody the other day, and he was talking about I was at the barbershop. Guy was talking about wanting to stay on his diet and stay disciplined and all this. No, he wanted to stop drinking. That's what it was. He said that he do good. He's a bodybuilder. He said he do good until he started back drinking. And his stomach get big and his body get out of shape and all that. And he said, I just do go up and down. He said, I have good smear. I said, well, I'm going to tell you how to stop drinking. He was like, how? I said, go coach some boys. Go to the rec and find some boys to train them, weight train them up. Coach him or whatever. I said, invest your life into somebody else. I said, when you find your pleasure in something else, you'll quit losing time in bars. Huh? Amen. See, I ain't got time to lose in no bar. I don't have no free time, period. All my time, if I wanted, I could spend all my time already all spent. Let me just say that. When I go to bed at night, I'm thinking the things I didn't get done. Huh? I wanted to do, but I couldn't do. Huh? Lives I wanted to touch, but I couldn't touch. So I don't have time to lose hours in a bottle. Are you with me?
Amen.
The reason why you caught up in some of the things you caught up in is because you're not doing what God really wants you to do, what he made you for. Huh? God wants you to be God wants you to smoke. My pastor say, put a chimney on your back. Huh? But we waste time doing stuff that God didn't want us to do, didn't make you to do. He didn't make you for that. Your lungs don't do well with all that smoke.
Amen.
Not against
cigarettes so much, but I'm just trying to show you an example of what we do. My folks start smoking because when they go on the job, the smoking folks get to take breaks, huh? Come on, really? So you're going to destroy your lungs just so you can take a long break and do nothing.
Amen.
Look at your neighbor and say, don't do nothing.
Don't do nothing.
Huh? Look at your neighbor and say, don't do nothing.
Don't do nothing.
Now go back to that first neighbor and say, do something.
Do something.
Give God an opportunity to do something with your life. And most of you have dreams. If I sit, when I sit and talk to you, well, I really want to help women, battle women. I want to do this, I want to do that. Well, do it. Get off the couch.
Amen.
Call one. Start with one. Huh? Somebody say start with one.
Start with one.
I promise that person there can take all the time you got. Huh? You help one person get back on their feet. You be riding by the liquor store. Oh, no, I'm going to stop and get some liquor. I'm heading on such and such. Because at the end of the day, there are so many ways to find your pleasure in the Lord. It's pleasurable to me to help people. Probably the greatest pleasure I have in life is helping people. Amen?
Amen.
I have so much more pleasure doing that than drinking liquor. I didn't even have pleasure drinking liquor. I drank liquor because my life was terrible. Huh? It was a sign that my life wasn't good. Now that my life's good, I don't even think about that. You understand what I'm saying?
Amen.
So, if you understand that, then what he's saying is, give your life to God. First, die to the flesh. Become alive to God. And allow him to make something out of your life. Now, the rest of that down to verse 18 is a lot more there. I'm not going to be able to make all through all that. Read that passage again. But today I want you to understand what we're talking about. We're talking about being baptized. There may be one more thing I need to say out there. I think there is something at the end. Let's see. That's another scripture. I ask you today to take seriously this opportunity that you be baptized. We were talking this morning, a couple of points that I think came out this morning was one, if you be baptized, it is you putting yourself in God's way. In 1 John, I think it's chapter 5, it says that there are three witnesses in the earth. The Spirit, the blood, and the water. The water is a witness, the Bible says. So when you go down into that water and truly surrender your life, the water marks you as somebody who has made a decision for Christ. The water witnesses it. I believe that when the angels come looking to see who they're going to come serving, they're looking for a witness. They're looking for somebody to witness your death. Huh? Because the angels come to help dead folks. Folk that are dead in this life, but alive in Christ. And they come looking for a witness. Is anybody to witness to this man's death? Hmm? So you can't get the insurance money to somebody witness your death. Am I right about it?
Sure.
They have to get somebody to come by and identify the body. Am I right about it?
Mm-hmm.
So the water identifies that you are one who died with Christ. The blood of Jesus identified that you died with Christ. And the Spirit also is a third witness that says this person is died with Christ. And so all of a sudden, you become eligible for some benefits. Am I right about that?
All right.
So you need to understand that when you go down in the water, you automatically put yourself in a